Well, good morning, and what a blessed Easter weekend we had together. I pray your heart was encouraged and strengthened in Christ, and just that hope that we have is so certain and sure. Well, this morning, as I promised, we're going to start studying the book of 1 Peter together. It's kind of hard to walk away from Genesis. I was loving it. But God is overflowing my heart as I'm praying over this letter and have begun studying it. And I'm asking him to do great things in our hearts and in our midst and to the ends of the earth. This is truly a beautiful epistle to study at this time, I think, in the history of our land. We've kind of lived, and I like to call it the not normal bubble of America in the last 300 years. And we're slowly but surely moving back to what God said the world would be characterized in this season between the two advents of Jesus Christ. 1 Peter is a letter that is loaded with deep and beautiful instruction on suffering, how to think about it, how to endure it, how to glorify God in the midst of it, how to live in a society that just hates you. They mistreat you, there's unfair treatment, and they persecute you for the name of Jesus Christ. How to be a light as the common graces of our land are being removed from us. The outright rejection by our government and the people of the government. The laws of unrighteousness being passed and paraded and hearty approval being given to them. It's a time where a group called ISIS, a Muslim extremist group, I was reading this week where one of the leaders swore to Allah. He said to America, you will not have safety even in your dreams until you embrace Islam. They're martyring Christians at an alarming rate. John Piper lives in Minneapolis. He said 80,000 Somalians have been brought into that city, and he said, we love that. What an opportunity for the gospel. But a large group was arrested who were trying to join forces with ISIS. And that really is the day and age now that we live in. And it should be no surprise when the terrorists attack our churches and us on a regular basis. The times that we live in are unstable. They're different than the last 300 years. And so we need books like 1 Peter to refresh our hearts and to teach us, how do we be aliens in this world? How do we suffer well? The flow of Scripture is, you suffer well and it ends in glory. Christ came and suffered and it ended in glory. How do we suffer well? Also, we live in the day of a growing prosperity gospel. It's being spread more and more that all God wants is to make you healthy, wealthy, and wise. And last week I made the confession, I used to be an accountant. Well, this week I want to make a confession. I believe in the prosperity gospel, but not until Jesus comes back to this earth the second time. When he comes back, he says, you will inherit the earth. You will be joint heirs with Jesus Christ. You talk about prosperity. It's going to be amazing what's coming at the end of this. But for now, this gospel is a call to take up your cross and die and follow after Jesus. Suffering and rejection is the path to glory. Following Jesus in this day and age could get you killed. And so I need this epistle to get my prosperity mindset in line with God's program and how to think about this world that I live in right now and how I should suffer and how I should live in the midst of it. And then lastly, we're going to see the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ in this epistle. There's such beauty to see and behold in this letter. May God show us much more of that sweet Christ. And I pray that we would quit fighting to get our old America back, but that we would fight to start proclaiming the glories and the beauties of Jesus Christ, willing to suffer at the hands of godless people. And so may God meet us and teach us these things in his epistle. Let's go before God and ask him to teach us in the book of 1 Peter. Father, we come delighted to open your word. We rejoice that we have an epistle called 1 Peter. God, I thank you that I can open it and we know it is the inspired word of God. I don't want to hear from this world anymore. I want to hear from God. And I thank you that we have the privilege to come together as God's chosen, called out people to come and open the Word of God and to ask that your Spirit would illuminate, that you would teach us and show us these truths of how do we live in a day and age that we now live in. How can we be aliens and sojourners in a crooked and perverse generation? God, we need your wisdom. We need your guidance. And so I pray that you would meet every individual heart, that you would meet us corporately and individually in this word. I pray that you would teach us. God, we want to live these kind of lives. And we live in a day and age where holiness is not longed for, even in many areas of what is called the church. And so I pray that this local assembly would hunger and thirst after righteousness. God, I pray that we would not let our love grow cold in the end days. So we pray, Lord, that you would stimulate us unto love and good deeds in this season in 1 Peter. God, I pray that we would be overwhelmed, that our hearts have been sprinkled clean, that we might obey Jesus Christ. Please stir that in every heart at Southside Bible Church. Lord, that we want to obey the Lord Jesus Christ. Show us how. Teach us and instruct us and guide us and give us the motivation in this first chapter to live holy lives. So God, meet us. We can't do this. No human strength can do this. So we look only to you. We're asking you to do your work through your Spirit by the Word of God, that you would get all the glory and praise and honor. Amen. If you'll turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1. Verse 1, Peter, I just couldn't get past that word this week. That's all we're going to look at this morning. I want to look at who's writing this. It just gives wings, really, to the words that we're going to study throughout this epistle. And so just this morning, I want to give you a little background about Peter. In Matthew 16:17, he was called the son of Jonah. He's the younger brother of Andrew. In John 1, we're told that. He was brought up by the shores on the Sea of Galilee. By trade, he was a fisherman. His father more than likely died while Peter was young because in Matthew 27, he was raised by Zebedee. His companions growing up then were Andrew, James, and John. Most probably, they were instructed in the scriptures of the coming Messiah then at that day and age and that time. Peter was married before he became an apostle in Matthew 8:14. We're told that. He started well so many times in the Gospels, but he didn't finish well on the water. Jesus, if that's you, command me to walk on the water. And in boldness, he jumped out and began walking to Jesus. He saw the waves, and Peter sunk. Many times, he makes the confession. Who do people say I am? Jesus asked, and Peter said, you're the Messiah, the Son of God. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you, but the Spirit of God. And just a few minutes later, Jesus says, I'm going to have to be crucified and buried. And Peter grabs Christ and says, no way. And he rebukes the Savior. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. That's not a compliment. Get behind me, Satan. You got your mind set on man's instead of God's. And so many times, Peter began well, but he didn't finish well. There are four lists given of the apostles in the Gospels, and Peter is always listed first. He was known to be the inner three with Jesus. His name was Simon Bar-Jonah. He was given another name by Jesus, which is Peter, which means rock. No apostle spoke more to Christ. No apostle that Jesus spoke more to recorded in the Scriptures. He is the only one who, again, reproved his master. He just appeared to be the mouth for the apostles. It's too bad that mouth was foot-shaped. He was impulsive and he was impetuous. One man said he was as tumultuous as the sea that he fished. But what I like about Peter is there was no middle ground for this man. He was either all in or he was all out. He loved Christ and he left everything to follow hard after Christ. He favored action at the expense of thought many times. Abraham Lincoln said, he who never makes a mistake never makes anything. His faith was tested greatly. He has the famous denial. was tested because he was following after Jesus Christ. Everyone else fled that day, and he followed him, and it was tested greatly, and he failed. Get out in the front lines, and there will be failure. Go home and hide, and you won't betray him. Peter, I want you to join with me and see then how the Lord Jesus shepherded this man into becoming a rock, into becoming the pillar for the early church. And what you see in the Gospels doesn't look like something to build as a foundation. And I want you to watch how Jesus took Peter and shepherded him. Rather than looking at his whole life, I want to bring you really to probably the climaxing work that changed this man for life and made him the great shepherd that he was to shepherd the budding church of God. So he was the one who would write a letter to the suffering church on the eve of the Neronian persecution, where Nero would begin persecuting the church greatly. Peter is to write a letter. And so I just want to draw your attention to a key part, I think, in Peter's shaping. And you don't need to turn to it if you don't want to. It's Matthew 26, verse 30. I will read it. And after singing a hymn, all the apostles and Jesus, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And then Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike down the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee." But Peter answered and said to him, "Even though all may fall away because of you, I will never fall away." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I say to you that this very night, before a cock crows, you shall deny me three times." And Peter said to him, "Even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you." And all the disciples said the same thing too. And I believe in Peter's heart, there was no doubt, "I love you so much, Christ, I'll die before I would ever deny you." I want you to listen to Luke 22, verse 54. And having arrested Jesus, they led him away. And they brought him to the house of the high priest, but Peter was following at a distance. And after they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter was sitting among them. And a certain servant girl, seeing him as he sat in the firelight and looking intently at him, said, "This man was with him too." But he denied it, "Woman, I do not know him." And a little later, another saw him and said, "You are one of them too." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." And after about an hour had passed, another man began to insist, "Certainly this man also was with him, for he's a Galilean too." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." We're even told he cursed in another gospel. And immediately, while he was still speaking, a cock crowed. And it says, the Lord turned and he looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord and how he had told him, "Before a cock crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. When you love passionately, you grieve deeply. When you have sinned and hurt the one that you love so deeply. Words can only come short of the pain that filled Peter's heart when Jesus' eyes caught him at that third denial. I can only imagine what Peter's life then has been like since, as we come to this epistle. I wonder how many times he's played that scene over again in his mind. Have you ever had something traumatic happen to you and it just keeps playing? I imagine with Peter, this thing has run in his mind quite a bit. He's had many sleepless nights. That look that Jesus gave him on the third denial. One of the early church fathers said that it was reported that Peter wept every time he heard a cock crow for the rest of his days on earth. So what do you do with the proud owner of the world's most infamous denial? The one who is to be a rock is now a pool of brokenness. Imagine the apostles are shocked at Judas's betrayal and suicide, but I believe they were more shocked at Peter's denial. So now what do you do with Peter? What do you do with him? It appears his life has been broken and he's no good for any work or service. Put him aside and be done with him? We close the Gospels and we see this broken, devastated man who denied the one whom he loved supremely, and then he had to watch him be crucified. But then we open up the book of Acts and we see the Spirit of God on the day of Pentecost is poured out on the church. And Peter stands up and he preaches one of the greatest sermons that have ever been preached on this earth. And 3,000 people believe on the spot. We begin seeing him in Acts healing someone who was paralyzed. He brought a dead person back to life. People were just getting healed by his shadow passing over them. He's the center and the leader of the new church. He's the author of this amazing epistle and one other, 2 Peter. He was used so mightily for the kingdom of God. Because of Peter, inspired by the Holy Spirit, we get to be filled up with all this rich truth that he wrote 2,000 years later. He is still shepherding the church of God even this morning. It's so beautiful. The question is, how do we go from broken and devastated to a mighty man for the kingdom of God? I see so many who never come out of the spiral that Peter was in. And I want you to see one of the most beautiful restoration passages in all of the Bible. So if you will flip over to John chapter 21. The Gospel of John is one of my personal favorites of the four Gospels, and it's ministered to my spirit in so many wonderful ways over the decades. But John records the life and events of Jesus Christ. We watch his life and we hear his teachings unfolded in this Gospel. And we get that beautiful expanded version of the last night in the upper room in John 13 through 17, some of the deepest, sweetest teaching of Jesus with his apostles. We then see Jesus arrested. We see in John's description that Jesus was crucified. And we get one of the most beautiful explanations on Easter morning where Mary and the disciples then go to the tomb. And when they come, the angel says the stone it's rolled away. He's risen just as he said. And then he appears to the disciples to show that he is alive forevermore. And then there's doubting Thomas, and he comes and he cures doubting Thomas. Put your fingers in the holes. And then look with me in John 20, verse 30. Therefore, many other signs Jesus also performed in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. This should be done, shouldn't it? That's a perfect gospel. Just let's walk away. I wrote these things so that you would believe in the name of the Son of God, and that believing you might have life. The end. Except for one little thing. There's this little excursus at the end of this gospel, and that's John chapter 21. And it's weird. It's all about Peter. It just seems so anticlimactic. Here's Jesus, believe. And now let's look at Peter for a chapter. You don't end a letter at the climax of Jesus Christ, risen and finished, and go back to an apostle who blew it so badly, just haughty and self-willed. Why would we go back to Peter? Just doesn't fit to me at the end of a gospel. But for some reason, it does in John's mind as he's led by the Holy Spirit, that he inspired it. So God wanted this at the end of the greatest gospel that I know of, the Gospel of John. So why do we have it? I believe it's the ultimate restoration that we all need. At the end of our mess-ups, when we really blow it badly and we have broken dreams and all the things that will come, I think this is beautiful. When we think we have blown it so badly and we're no longer of any use for the Master, I come to John 21. I think the apostles needed this. What do we do with Peter? You named him Rock and he was a pebble. So come with me to the greatest restoration of an erring sinner. And I want you to hear this very clearly failing Jesus Christ, you are not beyond the reach of his restoring grace. Failing Jesus Christ, you are not beyond the reach of his restoring grace. I pray that that will refresh some hearts and souls this morning. I want you to see the reinstatement of a failed man of God. Look with me in John 21. I'm going to begin reading in verse 1. After these things, Jesus manifested himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. And he manifested himself in this way. Simon Peter and Thomas, called Didymus, and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee and the two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." And they said to him, "We will come also with you." And so they went out and got in the boat, and that night they caught nothing. But when the day was now breaking, Jesus stood on the beach, yet the disciples didn't know it was Jesus. So Jesus said to them, "Children, do you have any fish? Do you?" And they answered him, "No." I'm sure they're like, "No, I don't think that was a happy no. We fished all night. Do you have any fish? Do you?" "No." And he said to them, "Cast the net on the right-hand side of the boat and you will find a catch." That had to be so obnoxious to fishermen. Your problem is you've been throwing the net on the wrong side of the boat all night. So they cast, and then they were not able to haul it in because of the great number of fish, because Jesus said, "Fish in this lake, enter into that net." And therefore that disciple whom Jesus loved, which is John, said to Peter, "It's the Lord." And so when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put his outer garment on, for he was stripped for work. So he puts it back on, and he throws himself into the sea. But the other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards away, dragging in a net full of fish. So when they got out on the land, they saw a charcoal fire already laid and fish placed on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish which you have now caught." And Simon Peter went up, and he drew the net to land full of large fish, 153. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." And none of the disciples ventured to question him, "Who are you?" knowing that it was the Lord. And so Jesus came, and he took the bread, and he gave it to them, and he gave them the fish likewise. And this is now the third time that Jesus was manifested to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. And so there's our context. In the setting, I want you to see it's very similar to the three denials of Peter, where it was night, there was a charcoal fire, he's standing around it warming himself. And now I don't think it's coincidence that Jesus will ask him three times to affirm his love, because he denied him three times. And so what would be Jesus' first words to Peter? Can you imagine the intensity of the setting and this situation that we're looking at this morning? And so Peter, the proud owner of this denial, his heart is broken, and he comes, and you expect maybe Jesus to say, "Peter, don't feel bad," or "Quit being so hard on yourself," or how would Jesus deal with Peter? And we're going to look at that this morning. If you look in verse 15, I want you to see the first question, the first words recorded now. So when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" The Greek word that Jesus used here is agape. It's that strong love that comes from God himself. Do you agape me? The love that Peter had claimed he had for the Lord. Again and again, he claimed he had agape love. And now the first word said to Peter, after all that he's been through, all that he's suffering, "Peter, do you love me?" What a penetrating question. I imagine Peter's eyes began to tear. His heart is already ripped open and raw. And now the Son of God looks at him and says, "Do you have this wholehearted love of devotion for me?" And Peter's response is, he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He uses the word phileo, that brotherly love, that tenderness. Yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you. And he said to him, tend my lambs. So the first response is Peter says, God, you know, and that Greek word is supernatural intuition. And so what he's saying is, you're God, you know everything. So you know everything, and you know that I have phileo for you. You know, God, you know that I have a brotherly affection. Did Peter answer Christ's question? And I don't think he did. If you'll look at the question a little closer, he says, Simon, son of John, do you love me what? More than these. And I read all these commentators saying maybe it was the fish, maybe, you know, what is these? I don't think it takes a rocket scientist to figure that out. Who are the these? What did Peter say when Jesus said, Simon, you're going to deny me three times before the cock crows? He said, even if all of these fall away, I will not. Peter had a boast that his love was greater. And if everyone else falls away, my love is so great, I will not fall away. So Christ takes his finger and he sticks it in that broken heart. And he's saying, Peter, have you been humbled? Have you been broken from your own self-confidence? Are you broken from trusting in the power of your love instead of resting in mine? My love is so great, I will never fall away, was Peter's boast. My love is far superior than these. Many zealous, immature Christians do the exact same thing. We're more zealous than anybody. We've got the solas. I know the doctrines of grace. Suddenly, we are more godly than any other Christian who doesn't have the same understanding. And we bash everyone, and we wish everyone pursued after righteousness the way I do. Let me give you all my conscience issues, all my rules, because no one's as godly as I am. Your zeal is without knowledge. Peter now has seen his own heart. He no longer boasts of a superior love. He has broken and he's been laid waste before the living Christ, and he cannot boast anymore of a superior love to all the apostles. He no longer will claim that right before the living Christ. Now, Peter, tend my lambs. Take care of my little lambs. The brash, proud, self-driving man will never be able to nurture the little lambs of Jesus Christ that they are called to shepherd. The ones who know apart from me, Jesus, you can do nothing, can now tend the little ewe lambs. And so you'll never be able to be a shepherd of God's people until you've been broken of this self-confidence and this pride. And I got some of you sitting here who I've heard you even testify that no one sees how smart you are and how gifted you are in using everything. And until you're broken, like Peter here, you're not usable for the kingdom of God. And when you're broken, shepherd my little ewe lambs. Without this beautiful breaking, you will just beat the sheep and you will pound them with the word of God and you'll have no compassion. Peter, you're ready now to have the keys of the kingdom. Shepherd, tend my sheep. Look with me in verse 16 at the second question. And this had to kill Peter that he's going to ask him another time. And he said to him again a second time, Simon, son of John, do you agape me? So he drops the comparison. Okay, Peter, you don't still claim to have this superior love, but let's just drop that and let me ask you this. Do you love me? Do you agape me, Peter? Peter said to him, yes, Lord. He uses that again. You know, you're God. You know that I phileo you. You know that I have an affection for you. I'm not sitting here claiming even agape at this point. And he said to him, shepherd my sheep. You're ready to be a shepherd, Peter, that you're broken and you're tender and you're laid waste and you don't claim to be superior anymore. You're not trusting in your own love. Tender, shepherd my sheep. Look with me at the third question in verse 17. So he said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you phileo me? He just took the knife, and I think he drove it in even more as, Peter, you're claiming to have phileo for me, and I want to ask you, do you even have phileo for me? You almost feel like it would just would have brought him to his face, and he just would have wept. Peter, do you even have phileo? And it says, Peter was grieved, same way he was when he denied him. He is grieved because he said to him the third time, do you phileo me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And so he uses two different Greek words. The first one, he says, you know, that's the same word, oida. You have supernatural understanding. You're God. You're omniscient. You know all things. But then he pulls out this other word. He says, you know, gnosko, you have an experiential knowledge. We've lived together. We've walked together for 3 years, day and night. Jesus, you know that I have phileo for you. You've been with me. You've seen. You know that I love you. Then tend my sheep. And I love this encounter so much. There isn't even the slightest trace of pride or self-reliance or self-trust in Peter any longer. God chose the perfect trial to break him and make him ready now to be a shepherd, the rock. It's so sweet. Peter could no longer boast. He could only appeal to Christ, who knows all things and who knows him personally. Three times, you know, you know, you know. And twice at the end, you know, God, what is in my heart. And we both know it wasn't enough to sustain me in the time of testing. We both know it. I failed. It wasn't there. It wasn't sufficient. But there's enough within this heart to repent so deeply and to be restored to the living God and now to shepherd the flock of God. I remember that there was another time where Jesus told Peter how to fish and the same thing happened and Peter said, get away from me, for I'm a sinful man. And this time he puts on his garment and he runs to Christ. That's what salvation does in a heart. How many times do we have to come to God again and again with failure and with sin? And the only cry that you have is, Lord, you know. You know how badly I want to live for you. Just again and again, Lord, I just want to please you in every way. And I got to come to that throne of grace again. Just, Lord, you know. I failed. I'm repenting. You know this heart. If I could not have any flesh at all, I could live the way I really desire and want to. So we get three questions, we get three answers, and we get three expressions of reinstatement. Do you think that's a coincidence? Not hardly. The Lord has just fixed the three expressions of failure. I don't know the man. I don't know the man. I swear I do not know the man. Do you love me? Yes, yes, yes. How sweet to watch the chief shepherd prepare his under-shepherd for the task of tending the flock of God under very turbulent times as the new church now springs forth under the death of Jesus Christ and the kingdom begins advancing. Failing Christ, you are not beyond the reach of healing grace. Please hear that. Failing Christ, you are not beyond the reach of healing grace. But there's a prerequisite that must be answered by all of us in our restoration is do you love me? It's in the present tense. Do you love me? That is it. That's going to be the restoration point. Do you love me? The object of the verb is the most important thing. Do you love me? And so I want all the young men that I love so deeply at this church who are training for ministry. If our motivation for pastoral ministry is for our own worth, our own glory, our own proving, and if it's even above that, and it's built on love for people, it will not last. The work is too hard, the criticisms are too constant, and the appreciation will be rare. But what kept Peter at his task for this season now to be the chief shepherd in the church of God was love for the one who has died in my place and given me the gift of eternal life. It's about loving Christ. How do you endure all the bullets? It's worth everything to preach the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that is now where Peter's at. It's no longer about Peter. It is only about Jesus Christ. Shepherd my flock. Tend my lambs. That's what Peter had. He had love to the unseen Christ, as we'll see in chapter 1. When you have that, feed my lambs. And so I want you to hear this. If you have failed in your marriage, if you have failed in your parenting, if you've failed as a church member, no matter how much I pound on you, you will not engage the body of Christ and give your life away. If you have failed as a church member, if you have failed as an elder, if you failed in your resolves, I'm going to quit lying to my parents or demeaning my wife or gossiping or drinking or immoralities, there is restoration. And the restoration this morning is, do you love him? Do you love him? Do you repent because you love Christ? That's why you hate your sin. I hate it because I love him. And yet that's just the beginning of restoration. Many think that's the end. That's the beginning because there's one more key component. If you'll look with me now in verse 18 of John 21, Jesus didn't stop there. Peter's broken. He makes his restoration, his confession of love. And Jesus says, truly, truly, amen, amen, I say to you, when you were younger, you used to gird yourself and walk wherever you wished. You girded up your clothes, your loins, and you went whatever you wanted to do. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will gird you and bring you where you do not wish to go. Now this he said, signifying by what kind of death he would glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said to Peter, follow me. Follow me. Tradition tells us that Peter was captured for preaching the gospel. And they made him watch his wife be crucified first. He had to watch his wife be crucified. And then it was his turn. He said, I'm not worthy to be crucified like my Savior. I want to be crucified upside down. Does that sound like the same Peter we saw in the Gospels? The restoration is a call to undeviating discipleship. Jesus says, now follow me. Instead of being self-willed, Peter, follow me. Please hear this. This is not just sentimentalism. This isn't just a little emotional love. I feel something warm in my heart towards Jesus. The restoration is that because you love him, you will now follow him. You will give obedience to Jesus Christ. And John, earlier in his Gospels, he said in John 14, 15, if you love me, Jesus said, you will keep my commandments. A few verses later, he who has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him and will disclose myself to him. And a few more verses later, Jesus answered and said, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. And my Father will love him, and we will come to him, and we will make our abode with him. The Trinity, we will dwell in oneness together. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Not keeping my commandments is love. There's this beautiful principle of the gospel. If you love me, you will keep my commandments and you will follow after me. So Peter's now there. The restoration of Peter was real. And I want to let it preach to your heart this morning. The man who fought again and again, is now submissive. He is the restored shepherd of the church. And now he sees there's a persecution beginning, and it's growing. And we're right on the eve of what Nero is about to do. Nero is going to come, and he's going to start persecuting the Christians, and he's going to crucify them, and he's going to put them up at his party. He would hang them up on these poles and put pitch on them and just light them on fire. He's going to begin persecuting the church with a terror and a tenacity of just killing and wiping out Christians. It's awful what took place under this man. And now you are called to write a letter to the churches that have been scattered abroad, to strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble, to prepare them for what is coming on them. And so my question is, what would you write to them? If someone said to you, I want you to write that letter this morning, what would you write about? What would you say to strengthen the church and to prepare them for such a season? You're called to write a letter to the churches then. What would you say? Peter has this theme running through his epistle of submission. Submission. What was his battle? Jesus says, you're going to deny me three times. What did Peter say? Yes, Lord. If all these turkeys run away, I never will. That's not submission. I'm going to come and wash your feet. What does Peter have to do? No. Everyone else lets him wash their feet. No. No, you need this, Peter. Then wash my whole body. Peter, you're going to deny me three times. He predicts his coming death. I love that. And he rebukes him. And he tells him, no way, you're not going to die. That can't be that way. And he's rebuking Jesus. He's fighting him. He will not submit to God's way. And then what finally happens when Jesus says, my time is at hand? They come, and what does Peter do? He pulls out his sword, and he loves him so much, he'll fight the whole army. And he swings it at Malchus, and I think he was aiming for his forehead, and he got his ear. He was a fisherman. He wasn't a soldier. But even he just would not quit fighting the will of God. He was strong and stubborn, like some of you here this morning and like myself. Now you get to write a letter, and your theme for a suffering church is submission to God in the midst of your suffering. He learned his lesson. The theme is submission. I am going to go, and I'm going to be crucified upside down in complete submission to my God. And now the suffering church, allow the sufferings that have come into your life because they're from the hand of God. Quit fighting it. It's from God's hand. Be in submission to what God is doing. Therefore, he says in 1 Peter 4:19, let those who suffer according to the will of God entrust their souls to a faithful Creator in doing what is right. So I'm not going to teach you how to change the government, veto all their bills, you know, change the way Nero's acting. I'm not going to teach you any of those things. I'm going to teach you how to submit under the will of God to what is about to come upon you. This shepherd got it. Don't fight the will of God. Don't be self-reliant. Submit to the hand of God. Suffering first, then glorification. In this world, you will have tribulations. You will suffer. There is no prosperity gospel. You will suffer. Take up your cross, deny yourself, die. You're going to be hated on my account because they hated me. Submit. Suffer. Be engaged. Let the will of God come upon you. And what comes after is glories that you cannot compare to the suffering that you've had here on this earth. And Peter's going to come and he's going to bring us into that section. And he's going to tell us that. And so I'll ask you as we close out, can you answer these two questions this morning? Do you love me? In a present tense verb. Do you love Christ? That's how you can be healed this morning from your driftings and your failures and your hurts and where you're sitting. To just, I love you. Jesus, you know that I love you. And the way I know is I want to obey you. I don't want you just to feel good about me and my sin and staying there. And I want to get out of it. I love you, Christ. I want to obey you. I want to follow you. Professions of love mean nothing. Will you resume, Peter, undeviated discipleship? I want all of you. Quit telling God how he has to do things. I want my own way, my own wisdom, my own strength, submission. Come under the will of God. Come under the lordship of Jesus Christ and follow him. This is where restoration will begin. This is what happened with Peter. So praise God now for John 21 and what God did in Peter's life. And now we get to come sit on his lap for the next year and just learn and be discipled by this shepherd who knew Christ, walked with him, was broken, and was such a beautiful leader that he could tend the little ewe lambs of God. And so let's come and open up this word and learn from Peter. And so I pray that God would bless our study in the days and months ahead. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for John chapter 21. I thank you that you don't just discard broken saints or ones who fail. You're not one that just leaves them. We watch you come and draw Peter in, and you did a heart surgery. You didn't just give him false comfort. You brought him into that place because you wanted to change and transform and let him be the rock that you called him to be. And so, God, I pray for anyone in this congregation this morning who has drifted into this. God, who feels like they're on plan B, feels like their life can never be useful again for the King of Kings, I pray that you would take that lie of the devil right from their ears. I pray they would hear the words of God this morning. What you're looking for is a love for you and a submission, an obedience, a following after Christ. And so many of us have to be crushed in order to do this. We're self-willed, God. And I thank you that you handpick trials that break us and bring us under the almighty hand of God to entrust our souls to a faithful Creator in doing what is right. So God, let your people hear those words this morning in their ears and in their hearts. God, I thank you for what we learned from Peter this morning. And God, I pray that all of us who have been called to, if it's to shepherd little children, if it's to shepherd family members, to shepherd the flock of God, whatever calling, Lord, that in brokenness and humility we would shepherd the flock of God, looking to you, the good shepherd, that we would not trust in our own love, but we would trust in your love, Lord, a love that will not let me go. I rejoice in it, and I thank you. And I pray that you will meet us here in a special way in the epistle of 1 Peter. Prepare us to be a people that will stand bold and strong and firm under the squeezings and afflictions that will come upon those who desire to live godly in this present age. God, give us courage and strength. Give us love to Christ, a love to Christ that will follow Christ in this world. And so we need wisdom to know how to live, how to follow you in a hostile world. And so I pray that by your Spirit, through your word, you would give us that in this season. And so we thank you. Let our hearts be supple. Let us be teachable. And I pray that what would come out of this would be obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's in that sweet, precious name that we do pray. Amen.